ninth, I was happy to do that. When I was teaching at University of New Mexico, I had the opportunity to actually ring bells in the sanctuary. So my wife and I are familiar with the sanctuary because we'll be ringing the bell choir here. When we first moved to Albuquerque, we were living in the North Valley. I was telling somebody earlier today, and without children, that was an easy thing to do. When our daughter was born, commuting to bell choir all of a sudden became a chore, and so we had to drop out of that. But we remember our time here at Asbury very fondly, ringing the bells up here in the chancellery. Let me ask you to pray with me this morning. Oh God, lend beauty, truth, strength to my words. May they fall like sweetly cadenced chords, or burn like naked fires from out the dark, or fly like arrows swift and sure to their mark. Amen. When I was young, probably about 8 years old, my father was stationed with the Army at Fort Polk, Louisiana, and we lived off base. We lived way, way off base. We lived in a tiny rural community several miles from nowhere. And I have to tell you that it was, for me, the greatest, most adventurous place in the world to be an 8-year-old running around and playing there in the middle of nowhere. There was a creepy old barn-type garage on our property. There was a huge plowed over field that had once been a massive garden. And there was a forest of bamboo stalks as thick and as impenetrable as they were tall. And just a short walk through a cow pasture and down an old lane, there was a murky, dark pond with a dock. And the pond had trees overgrown all around it. Once I went with my dad to go fishing in that pond, and as mindless and as careless as an 8-year-old can be, I tagged along in his footsteps all the way down to the pond. Dad walked out on the dock, and he took great care to step over that one place on the dock where the wood had rotted away and left a gaping hole to the water below. And then he turned to me, white as a sheet, and said, "Stop, stop, stop. Don't move any closer." Whatever had been going on in my 8-year-old mind, whatever easy, breezy carelessness had consumed me up to that point, evaporated in an instant. I stood stock still. I don't think I even breathed. Dad pointed down through the gap in the dock where a water moccasin, a cottonmouth, had coiled itself up. Danger lurked just beneath the surface, and I never knew it. We did not go fishing that day. I think my poor dad was too shaken up to even consider it. But even to this day, I can remember the rip, the tear, the sudden shift in that whole day, how everything changed in an instant, in the blink of an eye, and how time stood still. The air around me stopped moving. In our gospel reading from the gospel according to Mark for today, here at the beginning of Jesus' public ministry, Jesus of Nazareth heals a man who is captive to an unclean spirit, some dark, evil, demonic force. Jesus silences that spirit and commands it to come out, to leave the man, to liberate him, to set him free. And we hear in this passage how the people who were nearby, when that happened, we hear how they were amazed, how they were shocked, how they were stunned. Some English translations even indicate that those nearby were shaken or scared, a little terrified, frightened by this turn of events. To my mind, it must have been one of those moments that you could just encapsulate in time. Like that moment for me out on the dock when life turned on a dime. That's what it's like when the power of God is let loose right in front of you. That's what it's like when you're going one way and life and God intervene. That's what it's like when you're brought to that place of shocked and stunned stillness, and in that place of shocked and stunned stillness, God moves. So I wonder this morning, when in your own experience, when in your own in your case it was a friend or a family member or a loved one, or maybe it was a complete total stranger and you just happened to be nearby, you know, you just happened to be an innocent bystander to the awesome power of God. And I wonder if in that instant you felt the silence, the stillness, the terror of that moment. Or maybe it was in your own life. Maybe you were not the bystander, but it was you that was healed, or it was you that was touched, or was moved, or otherwise struck by the power of God. I wonder if you can recall a moment when God did something spectacular, remarkable in your life, and that moment, that instant, is crystallized in your memory, partly because you were frozen to that spot, unable to move, completely still, and God did all the moving for you. For the children of Israel, without a doubt, that moment was the Exodus, the deliverance from captivity to Egypt. Actually, the story of the Exodus, if you follow it along, is a story with a series of moments, with episode after episode after episode, with event after event after event, where God moves, and the people can hardly do anything but stand still and watch. In our Old Testament reading for today, we have one of the more dramatic moments from that story, is that the Hebrews have been set free from Egypt, but they are at this point pressed up hard against the Red Sea, and the armies of Pharaoh, who changed his mind about setting them free to begin with, now bear down on them from behind. Danger surrounds them front and back. And in terror and in anguish, the people stir and grumble against Moses, but Moses doesn't hear any of it. "Don't be afraid, don't be afraid," he shouts. "Stand firm, stand still, what God will do." I wonder in that moment how hard it was to believe. I wonder in that moment how hard it was to really stand still, to do nothing. Because I have to imagine that the Israelites, pressed hard by the chariots and horses of Pharaoh's mighty army, pressed against the waters of the Red Sea, I have to imagine that they were struggling as hard to stand still as I was out there on that dock, when every fiber, every muscle, every instinct, every impulse was screaming, "Run! Run for your life!" There are times, however, when the best response, the best thing you can do, not do anything. Sometimes, when you're pressed up against insurmountable odds, when it looks like, or feels like, or in point of fact, is like, danger is all around you, in that moment, being still, being quiet, not doing anything is really the best thing you can do. And sometimes, in your stillness, God moves. January of 2005, our then 2-year-old daughter Sophie began to develop small, mysterious, unexplained, fingertip-sized bruises on her legs and on her arms. And when they didn't go away after a day or two, we asked the teachers at our preschool if she'd been falling down or running into things more than usual. And they said that she hadn't, but they noticed that she was a little pale and tired and suggested that maybe we take her to the doctor. So my wife Susan and I went to urgent care with Sophie. The doctor there thought maybe Sophie was anemic, and he called up some blood work. At that time, I was still in seminary, and I had classes later that day, so I left Sophie at home with Susan, and I went on to school. Between classes, I got a call from Susan. The blood work had come back a little off. So our urgent care doctor was forwarding the results to a pediatrician that he knew in Raleigh. By the time I was heading home after my second class of the day, the pediatrician from Raleigh was calling me on my cell phone. "Mr. Partin," he said, "you need to take your daughter to either Duke or Chapel Hill Hospital as soon as you can." There was no explanation. There was no diagnosis. Just the urgency of getting her to the hospital. Soon. In a blur, in a haze, in a fog, when we that moment, pressed against the unknown, pressed on one side by what felt like death itself, and on the other side by a treatment regimen that we couldn't even begin to fathom, there was nothing to do but be still. We couldn't undo the cancer. We couldn't go back to before it existed. We couldn't wave a magic wand and make it or the chemotherapy go away. We couldn't even make sense of what was happening to us. And in that instance, actually, during many instances, during the 2.5 years that our daughter was in treatment, there was plenty of opportunities for being still and waiting on God. And it was quite easily the most awful and the most awesome formative experience of our family's life together. But let me share you something that we learned. God can move in mysterious ways. Of course, God moved in amazing, incredible doctors and nurses and sophisticated advanced treatments that would eventually cure our daughter Sophie, who's going to be starting 8th grade at Eisenhower this week. God moved in unexpected ways, in the collections that people took up to help us with the cost of the treatment and getting back and forth to the hospital, in the gifts and the cards from friends and strangers, including, I just want to add, a prayer quilt from Asbury United Methodist Church in Albuquerque, New Mexico. One of these appeared on the altar this morning. There was so much that we could not do. There were plenty of instances where all we could do was stand still and just be, to just prayerfully and hopefully take one baby step forward at a time. And God moved through all of that. And when lightning strikes like it did for our family, that the shock and the stillness can take over, and maybe that's okay. Because in the shock and the stillness, we got to see God at work. You know, I noticed something about the Exodus story that I have never noticed before. When you read on about when the Hebrews were caught against the Red Sea and they were crying out in fear and terror, Moses was telling them to be still, to hang tight, to hold on. In that story, God was around them the whole time. The angel of God was there. The fire and the pillar of clouds were there, even moving to keep the Egyptians at bay, moving behind the Hebrews. And during the night, the wind of God, the breath, the spirit of God blew across the waters of the Red Sea like it did at the dawn of creation, creating that dry land that the Hebrews would cross over on. What if, in those moments, when you and I are pressed on all sides, when we are shaken by fear and by terror, what if in those moments, if we take note, if we're still enough and quiet enough, we might recognize the glory of God, the breath of God stirring, moving, surrounding us. I'm no fatalist. I'm not one who tends to shrug and say, well, it's